I'm journalist and comedian James Mullinger. 7 years ago, I left London, England and moved to St. John, New Brunswick. Since then, my stand-up career has taken me to just about every town and city in Atlantic Canada, which, let's face it, has provided plenty of material. But I've also come to realise that this place is special and, crucially, underappreciated. So my wife Pam and I started a magazine, The Maritime Edit, to celebrate its natural beauty and the incredible spirit of the people here. Last year, here on Atlantic Edition, I embarked on a tour to meet some of Atlantic Canada's most interesting and dynamic people and chatted about what drives and inspires them and learned what they love so much about this place we're all so proud to call home. And now we're doing it again. I'm back on the road to meet even more fascinating Atlantic Canadians, and today I'm headed to meet Wesley Williams, better known as Maestro Fresh Wes. Wes is that rare talent, an actor, writer, radio DJ, speaker, and a multi-award-winning recording artist. He made history in 1989 with Let Your Backbone Slide when it was certified platinum and was the first ever rap song to be inducted into the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame. As an actor, he's appeared in numerous films and television shows, including The Line, for which he was nominated for a Gemini Award. And he displayed incredible comic timing and acting prowess as Vice Principal Paul Dwyer in the Jerry D CBC hit sitcom, Mr. D. Always reinventing himself, he surprised everyone earlier this year when it was revealed he'd moved to St. John, New Brunswick for a better quality of life, where he hosts a weekly radio show, Maestro in the Maritimes. I'm James Mullinger, and this is Atlantic Edition. There can only be one godfather of Canadian hip-hop, and sure enough, there is only one Maestro Fresh Wes. He's a contemporary of the likes of Chuck D and Snoop Dogg, and an inspiration to an entire generation of Canadian artists, from Cardinal to Drake. Wes is a bona fide legend, and he now lives right here in my chosen home of St. John, New Brunswick. He's taken the city by storm since his arrival, and has been described as the best thing to happen to St. John since incorporation. I've had the chance to get to know him and appear on his hit radio show, Maestro in the Maritimes. And I can tell you, he's as hardworking and kind in real life as he is electric and dynamic on stage. His decades-long career has been a true inspiration, and now he's using his influence to inspire our youth, speaking at schools around the region. I'm headed now to meet him at the Wave radio station where he hosts his show. And I can't wait to learn about how he stayed at the top of his game for more than three decades and what he loves most about his new life here in Atlantic Canada. Here we go.
Okay, party people in the house.
May I have attention, please?
In a moment, the beat will be played in many parts.
Yes, yes, yes. Once again, it's the Maestro Fresh Wes. You're listening to Maestro the Maritimes only on 97.3 The Wave. St. John, how you feeling, man? I'm feeling good tonight, Friday night. We made it. Who would have thought we would have made it through this week? But we're here.
This jam is amplified, so just glide, glide. And let your backbone slide.
Yes. What's happening, good?
How's it going? Great, yeah, man.
Clapping.
So good to see you.
Yeah, man. Lovely day, too, man.
It's a beautiful day in St. John.
Cool, man.
So this is where you record Maestro in the Maritimes?
Maestro in the Maritimes, man. Definitely.
How was the show tonight?
Show's beautiful, man. Yeah. Shout out to my man, Zach Perry.
Yeah, he's amazing.
He's the real maestro behind this, orchestrating everything, making sure I sound good. Yeah. So we got some bangers coming up. People going to love it.
It's amazing.
Yeah, man.
And how did the show come about?
Me and Zach had a little beverage at one of them joints over there. Picaroons are one of them spots. People like the show, so it's a blessing. St. John's beautiful, man, to be here. And people tend to like it. People tell me they tune in.
Yeah.
Every time I stand out here, people drive by waving. So it's the wave, so I'm waving back, you know?
Right? The Queen's Wave. The Queen's Wave.
The Queen's Wave, yeah, man.
I like it.
Yeah, man.
Oh, man, let's talk.
You okay? Let's rock.
You've been here for more than a year now. How would you describe your first year in St. John?
St. John is cool, man. You know, it's slower pace than Toronto.
Yeah.
Probably the nicest people I ever met. Yeah. You know, laid back. You know, a lot of beaches. You know, I did some cool events, met some cool folks. I like it, man. I like it a lot.
What's your favorite thing to do here?
My favorite thing to do? I don't even know yet, man. There's some, I'm still discovering some. You know what? Probably go to the beach.
Yeah.
Probably go to the beach. Bayshore Beach on the west end. That's probably like my favorite thing to do, just to like catch a vibe, you know? Drink a coffee and just chill.
And I think that's the biggest difference, right, between here and a big city, is that you can go to a beach, but then minutes later you can be in a pub or restaurant or a theater. I mean, has that been a bit of a culture shock, kind of?
That's a beautiful culture shock to me. Like, I'm at the beach almost every day if I want to, man.
Yeah.
I can go for a walk, I can just sit down, catch a vibe, see water, fresh air.
Have you skated on the frozen ice yet?
No, pushing it.
You're gonna do that. You're not a man of time until you've done that.
Nah, I think I'm good, man.
Yeah.
I think I'm good.
It's pretty terrifying, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. But nah, it's cool, man. I like being out here. It's a lot different. This is not a small city.
Yeah.
It's a very tiny town.
Yeah.
And what I had to get used to is like everybody knows everybody.
Yeah.
It's not like 6 degrees separation, it's like 1 degree, 1.5.
It's true.
Degree separation, so.
Everyone's connected in some way. And what was the biggest surprise, would you say, about this place? Because, I mean, for many years, the city didn't have the best reputation. Mm-hmm. And of course, I mean, you and I both moved here from different places and been impressed by it. But what was the biggest surprise for you?
The biggest surprise, probably, like, how accommodating people are, man.
Right.
Because, you know me, like, and you know, I'm from a bigger city, and you know, you got your guards up every minute. You see what I'm saying? People are kinder here because it's a smaller, close-knit, community.
Yeah.
It's a tiny town, man.
Yeah. Well, it's people have to be nice because you can't go around. I mean, I've learned very quickly when I moved here, if you sit at a dinner table and start slagging someone off, the person at the table will be their brother or sister. Like, and it kind of forces you to be nice.
Man, you'd be so busy, you get a punch in the face.
Yeah,
and you didn't even know what you did, man.
Yeah.
You got a punch in the face right in Sobeys, man.
That's it. When there's 1 degree of separation, you cannot make
anything. 1 degree, and there's no separation between get that knuckle sandwich for somebody you violated, you know what I'm saying? So you gotta be peace with everybody.
That's true. It forces us to be nice. It's created a very kind of real and organic society.
Exactly. And you know, I'm laid back anyway, so I could be more myself, more relaxed here.
Wes, you were recently here at the Imperial Theatre in St. John filming a beautiful segment for the Juno's 50th anniversary. How did that come about and how did that feel?
That felt great because I didn't want to go to Toronto just for that. I wanted to stay here to film it. And the Imperial Theatre was very accommodating. And shout out to my brother, Cardinal, because he held it down introducing me.
Yeah.
And I felt proud for when he said, like, you know, performing from the Imperial Theater in St. John, New Brunswick, Maestro, Fresh West, Let Your Backbone Slide. So salute my brother, man, you know? And they did a good job in you know, putting everything together with us being here and Toronto and that being out in Los Angeles. It was a good project. You know, I'm celebrating, like, it's over 30 years, man, you know? So for the fact that I'm a part of this here, it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And I mean, the fact that you were such a kind of trailblazer in Canadian hip-hop, I mean, the godfather of Canadian hip-hop, and there can only be one godfather. There can only be one.
Right.
Did it make you feel nostalgic when you were looking back, like looking back to the start of your career, winning that first Juno? What were the kind of emotions running through you at that time?
Oh, what, back then, when I was a kid?
Yeah, well, both, kind of, yeah. What did you kind of, oh,
when
you
I was
remember?
A kid, yeah. When I was younger and I did that, to me, I was representing my community. That was my whole thought process. It's like, this ain't just for me. Good, I got it. That's dope, you know? But this is for us. This is for moving forward. This is like a start of something big because there's artists coming up after me who are just as good or better and what have you. So I'm just glad it was me to be a part of that. But looking back in retrospect, it's like, I think I did a good job. That's what was going through my head. Like, when I look back at myself, you know, like how I did interviews and stuff. I was nervous and whatnot, but I think I represented. I definitely think I did okay.
Big time. I mean, how old were you when Backbone Slide kind of...
I was like 20 or 21.
Wow. You know? Presumably you had no kind of media training at that point. No one's been kind of...
Well, the media training came from Public Enemy. Right. I did some shows with P.E. And that's how I learned. That's how you navigate yourself being a professional. I learned from the best of the best how to treat people.
Right.
On the mic, off the mic, new fans. So all the stuff you saw, like, you know, we're walking over here. And then we see fans waving. It's like that's, you know, you compartmentalize. You treat them a certain way. When you're doing interviews, you're respectful. It's not just about you. It's about, you know, new fans who might not have heard of you before.
Right.
And you're teaching, indirectly, you're teaching younger artists how to do interviews and how to conduct themselves. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So every day is a different opportunity for that. So I don't take it for granted.
I mean, going back to the beginning, like, when did you first realize that hip-hop was something that you wanted to pursue? And when did you realize that it was a viable career option?
When I was 11, that's when I started rhyming. I wrote my first rhyme when I was like 11. When I was about like, I think maybe when I was like 19 at that time, 18, 19, I'm thinking like, yo, it's on, for sure, you know? 17, 18, 19, those times right there, it's like, it's on and popping with this, you know?
I mean, on the subject of fun, like those early years when the breakup happened and you were working with Public Enemy, I mean, what was it like suddenly going from writing a song in your bedroom to playing these huge crowds, touring the world? What was that like?
I mean, I don't know about touring the world, but touring Toronto, let me tell you something, man. That was like an out-of-body experience, and it affects you psychologically, too. And that's something I never really spoke about coming up. But when you see yourself as a normal dude, but people check for you at a different level, you know what I'm saying? If you ain't grounded, that could affect you psychologically, because we all got insecurities and stuff like that. They say humility is a skill that we gotta practice, but sometimes it's hard to be humble in this arena when you're around like egomaniacs, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You gotta pick your battles.
I mean, did you feel that pressure in the early days? Were you aware of the fact that you were a pioneer?
Yeah.
You know, the first hip-hop artist to win a Juno. You were kind of, you know, breaking new ground. You were...
Yo, did real you talk, feel... real talk, I'm the first black artist to go platinum in Canada, man.
Right.
And you gotta understand, like, when I came out with my first record, that was like 1989. Before that, a lot of people don't know, but shout out to my brother Ben Johnson. Ben Johnson was the fastest man in the world, straight out of Toronto. And you know, he did his thing, went to the Olympics, got his gold medal. And then in a split second, you know, he got what they call now cancel culture because of certain things that went on. But I watch how the country gave him love so quickly, then boom, next minute he ain't, you know, they treat the brother like he ain't Canadian anymore, he's Jamaican born. I never forgot that. So even though like I'm shining the very next year, that was my point of reference. You know, that, you know, at any minute, you could do something or whatever like that, and they flip. So my whole thing is make sure that, you know, I try my best to make sure my family proud of me. Mm. I try my best to, and now the point is, I try my best for my son to be proud of me. You feel me?
Yeah,
because totally. You don't know, tomorrow's never promised. But the reference point I had when I came out was that was the only dude that did anything from Toronto on a world stage.
Have there ever been, you know, dips and ebbs and flows in that time where you've either felt down or felt frustrated with the industry?
Yeah, hell yeah, man. Hell yeah. A lot of times that happens. But the beauty with my specific situation is after I saw Tupac in Juice, I'm like, wow, man, let me try acting. Let me study acting.
Right.
So when I started acting, I started going to like acting classes. I studied with the best acting coaches in Toronto. But from 2000 to 2013, there was no albums. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, wow.
From me.
Yeah.
But if you want to look at all the TV projects, film projects I did within that time slot, you'd look at it and be like, I've been pretty consistent from a multimedia perspective.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So.
And one of my favorite songs of yours is Lennox Lewis, which again, named after and about my favorite British boxer, but also, I mean.
Okay, we're gonna battle now, we're gonna fight. He ain't British, B. Lennox Lewis is from Toronto. Lennox Lewis is from Kitchener-Waterloo. Big up. He got a fake accent just like you. You know what I'm saying?
We're all faking it.
You know what I'm saying? He from Toronto. Lennox Lewis, if he's right now, he's skin and teeth. If he used to see this, he's from Kitchener-Waterloo. It's all love, man.
We're doing accent swaps.
Yeah, just don't knock me out. I'm good. I'm one of the good guys. You know?
So throughout your musical career, what would you say are the personal highlights?
The personal highlights, man. That's a tough one. There's different personal highlights. You know, one of the personal highlights was performing here, but another personal highlights is you probably winning in the Juno. Opening up for Public Enemy, that's one of the highlights right there too.
What was that like that night? Tell me about that night.
I did a few shows with him.
Yeah.
And Chuck, you know, we're friends, man. He wrote the foreword for my first book. And Cardinal wrote the foreword for my second book, you know? So Chuck D was like a mentor to me. And according to Cardinal, I'm one of his mentors. So how cool is that to have them both write forwards for my book? So those are highlights of my career as well. But maybe performing with Tragically Hip for 100,000 people in Manitoba. That was pretty dope.
And I mean, I've mentioned so many of the tracks of yours that I love. I mean, how has your writing style evolved over the years? And what is your writing practice? Like, how do you sit down to write a song?
I got different ways of doing it. The way I look at it is like Quincy Jones didn't just play trumpet. He became a conductor. He became a producer doing, you know, contemporary jazz in the 50s and 60s, doing disco records for Michael Jackson in the 80s. Right. So because of that, that's how I look at it, how I approach music, where it's like, what you did back then is cool, but expand. And don't be afraid to expand. Don't be afraid to grow and develop and try different things.
Amazing.
Yeah, man.
And what about your personal playlist? Like, what are you listening to these days?
Free to Pain, Band of Gold, some Brand Nubian. What am I listening to? Ucha by the Stair Steps. You know, just cool music, good music, man. That's it, just good music. That's all I can say. Stuff that makes me want to think, stuff that makes me want to, like, clean my house, stuff that makes me want to do different things, man. Music, it's therapeutic.
My friend.
Yeah, man.
Mm-hmm. Here we are.
Yeah.
You've had such a multifaceted career. What was it that first attracted you to acting, do you think?
When I saw Tupac play Bishop in Juice, it was like, all right. You know, I thought that Boys in the Hood was really dope with Ice Cube, and obviously New Jack City with Ice-T. Yeah. But when I saw Tupac in Juice, That was it. A lot of people want to do songs with Pac. I want to do a movie with him.
Right. Yeah. That would have been amazing.
Yeah.
And so when the role came up for Mr. D, I mean, that was your first comedic role, was it? And did it make you nervous to be kind of around stand-ups and people like that? Or was it something that you knew that with your acting training you'd be able to kind of...
Well, there's different types of humor. There's like American humor, and then there's like Canadian humor, which is a lot like British humor, which is more subtle. Mm-hmm. So because the character was, there were subtleties within that, is what made it hilarious.
Right.
You know, if the character of Paul Dwyer that I play, if he was up and loud and boisterous, it would have taken away from the humor of the character.
Because as you say, I mean, one of the genius things about Mr. D was that it was played straight by the cast. No one was playing it up. No one was trying to be the funny guy.
It was
the humor came from the brilliance of the writing and the nuance of the performances.
So they'd be like, yo, Wes, when we did the rap party for Mr. D, they're like, yo, Wes, man, you're so funny, man. I go, I ain't funny, it's the writing. The writing was dope. The writing was hilarious. Sometimes I got in trouble for like laughing. They'd be like, cut. Wes, stop laughing. But they can't really get vexed at me because y'all wrote the funny shit. Like, you get vexed at me. You wrote it and I'm laughing, you know?
I mean, did you imagine that Mr. D would last as long as it did?
I don't think Jerry D thought that either, man. But it was a beautiful cast, beautiful crew. And we gelled, man.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And then in addition to acting, I mean, you know, you've obviously written a few books now, but the first one was both a memoir, but also a motivational and inspirational book.
Yeah.
How did that come about, and how did you find the writing of that kind of, because you seem to really open up and bare your soul in there.
Yeah, that was more of a motivational than a memoir, man. Mm. I just gave little anecdotes of a couple cool things that I've done throughout my life. But people have come to me throughout the years, James, and said, listen, man, we grew up listening to your music. That song you wrote, Stick to Your Vision, means a lot to me. And this kid had Stick to Your Vision tattooed on his arm one day. And I'm like, wow, okay, well, maybe that's what I should do, write this book that I've been putting on the back burner for years, man.
It's a hugely inspiring book. And of course, I mean, it's led to this, again, another facet to your career of motivational speaking, inspiring people. And what advice would you give to people for dealing with haters?
A lot of times, you know, the biggest haters us. A lot of times we hate on ourselves the most, you know? Once we tap into that insecurity and go forth and forward, it's more layers of confidence within us, man, because we'll always be ridiculed. Me as an artist, I always said to myself, not everybody loves Bob Marley. Not everybody loves Stevie Wonder. So who the hell am I to think that everyone's going to like my joints? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So like knowing that, I realized like, listen, man, just do the best version you can. Mm-hmm. Be the best version of yourself and take it from there, man.
Yeah.
And that's it.
And I mean, the motivational book has also now become a whole new book for children, Stick to Your Vision. A book that I dearly, dearly love and have read to my kids numerous times.
Yeah.
How did that come about? And when did you know that you wanted to tell that story to younger children?
I think when like COVID really hit us hard in terms of doing presentations and stuff like that, and the kids' book was always something I wanted to tap into. And then my co-author, you know, is a teacher, 20 years teaching at a school in Toronto. So she's like, yo, when you came to our school, did you see how those elementary school, like grade one students loved you? Maybe you should write a book. And I'm like, wow, yeah. And I think it's cool where the first one is more cerebral. The second one is more animated for the younger generation. So then I got the song Backpack Check. So now it's like even a younger generation where you got like from 2-year-olds to 10-year-olds for that alone. So that's intergenerational. That's what I try to do in my career. So that's what I try to do. And hopefully the young maestro character will evolve for another 20 years, man, you know?
And like I say, I mean, I love the book. Both of my kids love it. And I've ordered numerous copies of it and gifted it to people. And I ordered the limited edition signed one.
Yes.
But I was hoping today, if I could ask a favor, and you could do me a personalized signed one to my kids, Hunter and River.
Hunter and River,
Hunter
man.
Hunter and River. They're
man.
Very, very maritime names.
To Hunter and River,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, thank you so much. They will be so excited. So with all of the awards and achievements that have come your way over the more than 3-decade career, what are the ones that mean most to you, would you say?
I mean, the Junos was cool just because it symbolized like a start of something, you know? I think, you know, being in the Hall of Fame, the first hip-hop artist to be inducted in the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame, that's cool stuff, you know? I kind of compartmentalize. Like, that's the music accolades, you know? Mm. Me trying to be a good dude is where it's at for me, like, you know? Like, I was just coaching these kids yesterday. They're like, yo, man, thanks, Coach Wes. I'm like, good, man. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's a different type of accomplishment, different type of accolade, what have you, making that type of impact. So, and another thing too, I don't try to lie on my laurels. Like whatever I did back then, it's done. Mm. It's what you're doing now, we're doing today. You know what I'm saying? So.
Could not agree more. I mean, looking back, are there any things that you wish you'd done differently or things you wish you'd known at the beginning that you know now?
I mean, there's a lot of things. We'll be here for a long time, but my whole thing is just evolving, man. Mm. From that, using those lessons. And grow from there, you know? And I think that's where I'm at right now. So, you know, coming up, I learned that, you know, not everybody's gonna be that rapper, dapper, snapper guy. Not everyone's gonna be in that number one slot. So you gotta find other things to do and don't let your career or your passion be a liability to you. Find other things that you could be good at as well. And I think that's what helped me, you know, evolve and stay, you know, a part of having some type of longevity and perseverance that I found other stuff to do that I like as well.
Couldn't agree more. Thank you so much for a wonderful day, my friend. Listen.
No doubt, man.
Love you, man. And we'll do this again soon.
Cool.
All right. Yes, I have my people. The one and only Maestro Fresh West.
But I'm like, find one.
Great guy, great artist, and in Canada, he's a godfather. Like 100%. Those are my earliest memories of hip hop.
Yeah.
To make a toast. Sliding through, respect you. Slow. Yes, yes, yes. Yo.
I ain't Capone or Nori, but your boy was signed to the frat. 89 in the fact, try to diss your spine and get tapped. Back in the day, Toronto heads were really dying for rap. So I brought the gold and platinum certified with the plaque. We celebrating now, 30 years strong, still I'm motivated now. I reminisce on how they used to underrate a town. We started from the bottom, now they watching how we lay it down. Mine will stand up.